Hello world, I'm Attila, and today I will talk about the Sovereign Individual book. And this was a book like on the transformation from the industrialized, from this age of industry to the age of information, because this change is taking place now. And like robotic factories with the internet, this will radically like change our view of the world and change our lives. So it was very interesting to see, to hear its viewpoint. And it says that, this book says that individuals will become more powerful and more free at the expense of the state. So state power will decline. So ideas become wealth. So the most wealthy individuals in the world are those who has good ideas. So for example, Jeff Bezos and Elon Musk. If you just work in a 9-to-5 jobs, 9-to-5 job, you will get a little bit of money, but you won't be wealthy. And after a while, you will be replaced by a robot. So you shouldn't shoot for it. You should have ideas. And because these individuals are so powerful and they have so much money, they will be the next power in the world and the groups. So if few of these individuals group up, they will be like unstoppable, and this will be the end of nations as we know them today. So in order to explore this idea, this book uses an analogy to the 15th or 16th hundred, where the Catholic, like the church, became, the power of the church became like declined. So let's explore this. So citizenship was very important in the medieval times, because an individual like wasn't able to just grab a sword and go to the war or to protect its property, because like large numbers, like a big army had power where one individual with a sword did not have. So if you were part of a city, like the city protected you, and because of that you paid taxes. So church had a big power in the medieval times, because they wrote the books, they were the advisors of the kings, and the people trusted in them because of the religion. So they were able to like control them, and they had like a monopoly on the knowledge, because they were the, like, they wrote the books and they read them, because they were the only literate, like they know how to read. And it was very expensive to study at them, and they were able to like control the information. But then came Gutenberg, and he democratized knowledge, because with the printing everyone was able to have access to cheap books and knowledge. And these changes happening now, like with the internet, you don't need universities. You can learn about anything. You can have access to all the knowledge in the world throughout the internet. We used to like go to universities and study there for ages. And like to study at the university is very expensive, and it was like the student loans, and they are a big problem in the US. And it was expensive as in the medieval times to study at the church. So the church back then is the state today, and both declined. So states will decline as well. And the church also had like these massive debts, and like states, like United States has like tremendous amount of debt. Of course they can print as much money as they want, but that won't solve the problem. And then it talks about governments governments are controlled by the customers. So in a democratic system, the customers are the people who elect them. And that's why democratic systems are good. And governments have the role to protect their citizens and their property. So they make sure that nobody robs me. And because of that protection, we pay taxes. When technologies become more powerful, the power of the state will decline. Because with the internet, we can create assets that lie outside of the control of the governments. So let's take as an example Bitcoin. Bitcoin is like nobody can control it. It's outside of the state's control because it is protected by a very strong encryption. So it's like a money on the internet. And people will place their assets into the cyberspace. And because like taxes are a huge burden on everybody's life, of course you get protection for it, but like it would be better if we had protection and like little taxes. So when we like place our resources and assets into the internet, we will try to avoid taxes, and we will be able to do that because like this internet money will be outside of the control of the government, so they can't track who owns what, and they can't like control the transactions. So there will be this new currency on the internet without inflation, and that's like Bitcoin. But I personally don't really believe that Bitcoin will be the ultimate internet currency because of its huge inefficiency. So it consumes a large amount of power. So in my opinion, like a database, like a centralized database, would be better somehow, so that it is not controlled by the government. But that's like a place of discussion. Comment or follow me on Twitter, and we can talk about this more. But we will still require some protection on the internet. So for example, protection from hackers, so we can have a secure transactions between people. And so states will have some place in our world, but geographic location won't be important. Because right now I can invest in the US stock market with much less taxes than I would in the US because I'm in Hungary. But this geographic location will become even more irrelevant. So it used to be a big obstacle, but now it is not. Countries will have to compete with each other for the like lowest tax prices possible, and like the highest protection on the internet. As a result of that, we will have very low tax prices and even zero tax if we don't want that, and if we don't want protection on the internet. And then it talked about the robots and the automatization of factories. Fewer people will do more work with robot factories. So the people who have the ideas and who like design the robots, they will like the biggest winners. And instead of nations, there will be smaller cities or bigger cities which will focus on entrepreneurship instead of politics, because politics does not like add any value to our society. But if we train our children as entrepreneurs, they will like add value, and they will be able to think more for themselves, and that's like the very fundamental skill that is very important. Then the question arises, like if there will be no nations, so instead of nations there will be smaller cities or cities, will there still be nationalism? And this book says yes, because fundamentally nationalism is a human feeling, because we like belonging to somewhere and like a culture, and like nationalism gives us some identity. So in an online discussion I might say that I am a Hungarian, and it will tell like the people something about me, and so there will be still nationalism because we like belonging to somewhere. And that was this book. It was very interesting, however very like long, 400 pages, so if you have a lot of time and you are very interested in this topic, I would absolutely recommend you to read it. But I think these were the fundamental points. It was very interesting. I love thinking about the future. So if you are also interested in stuff like this, you should subscribe or follow me. And you should also follow me on Twitter, because I share like my new episodes and thoughts there. So that's it for today. Bye bye.